Psalm 145 says, I will extol you, my God, O King, and I will bless your name forever and ever. And every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. I will meditate on the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works. Men shall speak of the might of your awesome acts, and I will declare your greatness. They shall utter the memory of your great goodness and shall sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power. Father, thank you for this incredible day. Thank you that we get to declare your praises, that we get to share with men just how awesome our God is. And we will bless your name each day that we wake up and each day that we walk in. We shall declare your greatness and goodness and show forth your mighty acts. And Father, this morning I pray that as we spend time in your word, as we spend time listening for your still small voice in your word, God, that you would sow seeds that are fall on fertile soil, that we would have our hearts open to receive all that you have for us this day, that our ears would incline, that our ears would be attentive, and that, Father, we would hear you speaking even in this day. And so, God, I just pray and thank you for your awesome acts, your wondrous works, your splendid deeds, and I praise you for your awesome name. So, Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that we get to rejoice in it, get to celebrate with you. And thank you for your word this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, good morning, family. Good morning, friends. Trust that you're doing well. I can't believe how quickly time is moving on at the moment. But here we are again, having some time just to pause, to reflect on a week, to spend time in God's word. And I just pray that what I have to share with you this morning would fall on fertile soil, that it would touch a place in your heart, and it would cause you to walk in the fullness of all that God has for you. So won't you turn with me to Genesis chapter 45. Genesis 45, I shared last week on the place called Goshen, and I just want to pick up a few thoughts on it this week and just remind you of what I've shared and just pick up one or two more thoughts on it. So Genesis 45 verse 5 says, "But now do not therefore be grieved or angry with yourselves." This is Joseph talking to his brothers and sending forth word for them to come forth. "Because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For these 2 years the famine has been in the land, and there are still 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. And God sent me before you to preserve a posterity for you in the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So now it was not you who sent me here, but God. And he has made me a father to Pharaoh and the Lord of all his house, and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. Hurry up, hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me Lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not tarry. You shall dwell in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near to me, you and your children, your children's children, your flocks and your herds and all that you have. There I will provide for you, lest you and your household and all that you have come to poverty, for there are still 5 years of famine.'" And then in Exodus chapter 8, as the Israelites are in Egypt, and God is trying to get the Israelites out of Egypt, but the Pharaoh is a bit stubborn. In Exodus chapter 8, verse 20, we read the following about Goshen as well. "And the Lord said to Moses, 'Rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh as he comes out to the water. Then say to him, Thus says the Lord, let my people go, that they may serve me. Or else, if you will not let my people go, behold, I will send swarms of flies on you and your servants, on your people and into your houses. The houses of the Egyptians shall be full of swarms of flies, and also the ground on which they stand. And in that day I will set apart the land of Goshen, in which my people dwell, that no swarms of flies shall be there, in order that you may know that I am the Lord in the midst of the land. and I will make a difference between my people and your people. Tomorrow this shall be. And we looked at the whole subject of Goshen and how Goshen, the word Goshen, actually means draw near. It's a place in which we draw near to God. And God has set aside, not just in the physical, in the Old Testament, as we read about this place called Goshen, but in the New Testament and in the times that we're living, there is a spiritual place called Goshen. And I'll get to that in a moment. And we looked at 4 points last week. I just want to quickly mention to them about Goshen. And in Goshen, number one, Goshen is a place of separation. It's a place in which we've got to choose. We're either going to choose to be in Egypt, which is a representation of the world and its world systems, or we're going to choose to be in the place that God has set aside for us. Joseph, being a foreshadow of Jesus, went before his brothers, went before the people, and there was a place prepared, which was Goshen. It's a choice that we've got to make, whether we're going to separate ourselves from the world systems and go to the place that God has for us, or whether we're going to stay in the world systems. And that choice is important. Goshen is a place of separation. Number two, Goshen is a place of provision. God says, in that place, I will provide for you. We do not have to worry about provision in the place that God has for us, because God will provide for us. It doesn't mean that we don't have to work. They still had to tend the lands. They still had to tend to the flocks, the sheep, the goats, and everything that was running around. They still had to do work, but God provided for them. Number three, Goshen is a place of protection. As you saw in Exodus chapter 8, as Moses declares to Pharaoh, he says, the whole of Egypt is going to be full of flies, and in the houses and on the ground that you walk, it's just going to be swarms of flies. But in Goshen, not a single fly. Have you thought about that? How is that possible? Yet that is how God operates. When we're in the place that God has for us, we are protected. So it's a place of separation. It's a place of provision. It's a place of protection. And then lastly, it is also a place of multiplication. In Genesis 47, let me just quickly read this, because it's incredible to understand that even in what seems to be a place of isolation, if I can say that, to us in the natural, it's actually a place of provision and protection, but also multiplication. In Genesis 47, verse 27, it says, so Israel dwelt in the land of Egypt, in the country of Goshen, and they had possessions there and grew and multiplied exceedingly. When we walk in the place that God has for us, we have provision, we have protection, but that which we have also multiplies, and we become a blessing. And I thought this morning, what I want to share with you, I want you to turn with me to John chapter 14, and just to answer this question. So where is Goshen? Where is Goshen for us today? Us that are living in 2021 in the midst of everything that's going on, where is Goshen for us? Where is that place of protection? Where is that place of provision? And I want you to turn with me to John chapter 14, because the story of Joseph and the story of Exodus, it links up very much with where we live today. And in John chapter 14, Jesus says these words. It says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe in me. Let not your heart be troubled in this day. Let your heart not be troubled and grab hold of all the things that you're seeing in the natural. Let not your heart be troubled, because out of your heart flow the issues of life. But believe in God, and believe in Jesus, and believe in the Holy Spirit. Because it says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may also be. And where I go, you know. And the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? That's how it sometimes feels. I suppose in the day and age that we're living in, we sometimes go, God, we do not know the way. And how do we supposed to walk in this place of Goshen? Where is this place of Goshen? Because we do not know how to get there. But Jesus says we do know how to get there. We know the way. And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus says, I'm going to prepare a place for you in my Father's house, because in my Father's house are many mansions. One of the greatest revelations and understandings as a believer that we can grab hold of is to understand that the God of this universe, the God that holds the universe in the palm of his hands, the God that is creating time, is creating space, who's created everything, who knows the beginning from the end, that God, our Father, has a place specially designed in his heart just for you. And that is Goshen. Goshen is the place in the Father's heart that he has for you. When we draw near to God, which is what Goshen means, it says in James chapter 4 verse 8, it says, when we draw near to him, he will draw near to us. Goshen is the place in the Father's heart that he has for you. And when we draw near to God and we walk in everything that the Father has for us, we have provision, we have protection, and we have multiplication. When we draw near to Egypt, I believe that we have desolation, destruction, and loss. Because the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, right? But when we draw near to the Father, when we draw near to God, we find that place of Goshen, which is the place in the Father's heart, specially designed just for you. And there's a place in the Father's heart designed specially for me. And when we draw near to God, I believe we find protection, we find provision, we find multiplication. And the way that we get to the Father is through the Son. Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. If we want to live in Goshen, the only way we get into Goshen is through Jesus. The only way that Joseph's father and brothers got into Goshen was through him. It was a foreshadow in the Old Testament of what was going to happen in the New Testament. The only way we get into the Father's mansion or into the Father's heart is through Jesus. And we need to understand that as we come through Jesus, we find a place in the Father's heart. And it's the greatest revelation and understanding that we could ever have. And Jesus says to you this morning, you know the way, because you know where I've gone. We know that Jesus is seated at the right-hand side of the Father. We know that he's seated in heavenly places. And because we know that, we also know that we're seated with him right now. We're seated in heavenly places. We're seated in a place of provision, protection, and multiplication. And I want to break bread with you this morning on that basis, that as we've read the word and as we've understood the truth, that we know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and life, that as we break bread this morning, the eyes of your heart and your understanding would be open to know that you know the way, that your heart wouldn't be troubled in the day and age that we're living in, that your heart wouldn't be caught up in turmoil because of the things that you're seeing in the natural, but your heart would be set aside on the things of God and know that because you've come through the door, who is Jesus, you have access into the Father's heart, into the Father's house. And I believe that is Goshen for us today. It's drawing near to God and knowing that place of peace, knowing that place of protection, provision, multiplication, because we're in the perfect will of the Father. And the story of Exodus carries on. And I want to read that to you this morning out of Exodus chapter 11. Because we know that Pharaoh was stubborn. We know that this world system is stubborn. But we also know that every knee will bow its knee to the name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name. And in Exodus chapter 12, I want to read the story of the Passover as it was instituted. Because I want you to grab hold of this truth. I read a little statement this week, last week, which really reinforced just how great our God is and just how great his mercy and grace is. And the post went like this. It says, as the angel passed through Egypt, it didn't look into the house to see who was there. It just looked on the doorpost to see that the blood was there. The angel didn't look into the house to see who was in the house. The angel looked on the doorpost to see that the blood was there. And in Exodus chapter 12, we read the story. And this is the greatness that when we come to Jesus, Jesus paints, we have access to Jesus' blood, which washes us whiter than snow. And I want to say, Jesus' blood is sprinkled, painted on the doorpost of your life and my life. That as the enemy tries to come in, he sees the blood, Jesus' blood on the doorpost of your life and my life. And he knows he doesn't have access, because when we're walking in the perfect will of God, God's protection, provision, and multiplication is there for us. But let's read in Exodus chapter 12. It says, "And the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, On the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons. According to each man's need, you shall make your count up for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs. They shall eat it. Do not eat it raw nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire, its head with its legs and its entrails. You shall let none of it remain until morning, and what remains of it until morning you shall burn with fire. And that shall you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses we are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. So this day shall be to you a memorial, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it as a feast by an everlasting ordinance." What an incredible story, what an incredible institution of the Passover as it was instituted in Egypt, in the midst of everything that was taking place. And Jesus became our Passover lamb. Because of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, we have access into Goshen. We have access into the Father's heart, but we also have Jesus' blood painted on the doorposts and lintels of our lives. That when the plagues come and when the enemy comes, he sees that blood and knows he doesn't have access because of God's protection, God's provision, and God's multiplication. My prayer for you this day is that you would get a revelation and understanding that there is a specific place that has been designed in the heart of the Father just for you. You're not just another number. You're not just some creation. But there's a place in Goshen, in the Father's heart, specifically designed just for you. And it's one of the greatest revelations that we can ever get. You might say to me, "Derry, how do I get that revelation?" Well, I believe that as we come to Jesus, who is the way, he's the truth, and he's the life. As we enter in through Jesus, Jesus is the way. And because he's the way, as we follow Jesus, we follow him into that place that the Father has designed just for you and for me. And I want to break bread with you this morning. And so I want to read out of Matthew chapter 26 this morning. Matthew chapter 26. So I want you just to grab hold of the emblems. And we're going to break bread together. And I'm going to trust that as we break bread this morning, that the God's revelation, the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit, you would get revelation of just what Jesus did for us on the cross. As he was crucified, as he was buried, but as he rose on the third day and he presented his innocent blood before the throne room of heaven, that blood was shed for you and for me, that we might have access into this place called Goshen, But as I draw near to the Father draws near to me. And I have a place of protection. I have a place of provision. I have a place of multiplication. But it all starts with a place of separation. Am I prepared to separate myself out of Egypt and draw near to the Father? Am I prepared to accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior and say that He is the way, He is the truth, He is the life, and because I know Him, I know the way? Holy Spirit, I pray this morning that You would allow that to be a revelation to each person that listens, that we know the way and that we would walk in it, that our hearts wouldn't be troubled in the day and age that we're living in, that we wouldn't be caught up with everything that's taking place, but that our eyes would be set on You, Jesus, that we would follow You into the place that You have for us, specifically designed for each person, the place of Goshen, a place of drawing near. And in Matthew chapter 26, verse 26, it says, "And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread. He took the bread, He blessed it, broke it, and gave it to His disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is My body.'" So Jesus, we thank You for Your body that hung on the cross just for us, just for me, just for each person that is listening. And because You went through death, burial, and resurrection, we have access into the throne room of heaven. And Jesus, we thank You that because Your body hung on the cross, because it was broken just for us, we can have wholeness and healing today. We can have access because of that. And we eat this day in remembrance of all that You've done for us. We are grateful and thankful for all that You've done for us. And we thank You, Jesus, for Your body that was broken for us. And then He took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. For this is My blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the many for the remission of sins." And so Jesus, we thank You this morning for Your blood, the innocent blood that You shed for us, that we would be washed white as snow, that we can stand before the throne room of heaven, and because of Your blood, be innocent. Jesus, we thank You that Your blood is painted on the doorposts and lintels of our lives, and that the enemy knows that he doesn't have access. And I also pray this morning that Holy Spirit, You'd help us to understand that Jesus is the truth, He is the way, and He is the life, and that we know the way to the Father because of You, Jesus. Thank You for Your blood that was shed for us, that was shed on our behalf, that we didn't have to die, but we can have life, eternal life, and life in abundance. And in the place that where we follow You, Jesus, because of Your blood, we have protection, we have provision, and there is multiplication of all that we have, so that we too would be a blessing to others. We thank You for Your blood this morning, Jesus, that was shed for us. So thank You for allowing me just to share God's word with you. I pray for each person that's listening that you would have a revelation this morning or whichever day you're listening in of just how much God really loves you, and that through His Son Jesus, His Son has made a way into the place of Goshen, into the Father's heart, into the heavenly realms, and you and I can be seated in there knowing full well that we have protection, provision, and multiplication. God bless. Have an incredible week.